Hello, good evening. Let's have another little bit of Terry Pratchett's Guards, Guards. If you are following along, which you should be, with the Corgi edition, we're starting on page 52. Do about 12 pages tonight, so buckle yourselves in, because we'll be here longer. And if you remember, last night when we were reading the Secret Brethren Society, after a lot of shenanigans, put their magic items in a circle. They chanted the kind of noises that they expected to be chanted, and then it ended with the I can't remember what he's called, but the leader, when he opened his eyes again, he was in a dark alley, his stomach was full of fire, and he was very angry. So do you think he's turned into a dragon? Do you think that he thinks he's a dragon? Do you think that his mind has gone into that of a dragon? Who knows? Let's read a bit more and we'll find out. It was about to be the worst night of his life for Zebo Muti, thief third class, and it wouldn't have made him any happier to know that it was also going to be the last one. The rain was keeping people indoors and he was way behind on his quota. He was, therefore, a little less cautious than he might otherwise have been. In the nighttime streets of Ankh Morpork, caution is an absolute. There is no such thing as moderately cautious. You are either very cautious or you're dead. You might be walking around and breathing, but you're dead just the same. He heard the muffled sounds coming from the valley, from the nearby alley, slid his leather-bound kosh from his sleeve, waited until a victim was almost turning the corner, sprang out and said, "Oh," and died. It was a most unusual death. No one else had died like that for hundreds of years. The stone wall behind him glowed cherry red with heat, which gradually faded into darkness. He was the first to see the Ankh Morpork dragon. He derived little comfort from knowing this, however, because he was dead. "Nt," he said as his disembodied self looked down at the small heap of charcoal, which he knew with an unfamiliar sort of certainty was what he had just been disembodied from. It was a strange sensation, seeing your own mortal remains. He didn't find it as horrifying as he would have imagined if you'd asked him, say, 10 minutes ago. Finding that you are dead is mitigated by also finding that there really is a you who can find you dead. The alley opposite was empty again. "That was really strange," said Muti.
"Extremely unusual, certainly."
Did you see it? What was it?" Muti looked up at the dark figure emerging from the shadows. "Who are you, anyway?" he added suspiciously.
"Guess,"
said the voice. Muti peered at the hooded figure. "Cor," he said. "Oh, I thought you didn't turn up for the likes of me."
"I turn up for everyone."
"I mean, in person, sort of thing?"
"Sometimes, on special occasions."
"Yeah, well, this is one of them, all right. I mean, look, it looked like a blooming dragon. What's a man to do? You don't expect to find a dragon round a corner."
"And now, if you would care to step this way," said Death, laying a skeletal hand on Muti's shoulder.
"Do you know, a fortune teller once told me I'd die in my bed surrounded by grieving great-grandchildren," said Muti, following the stately figure. "What do you think of that, eh?"
"I think she was wrong."
"A blooming dragon," said Muti. "Fire-breathing, too. Did I suffer much?"
"No, it was practically instantaneous."
"Oh, that's good. I wouldn't like to think I'd suffered much." Muti looked around him. "What happens now?" Behind them, the rain washed the little heap of black ash into the mud. The Supreme Grandmaster opened his eyes. He was lying on his back. Brother Dunnykin was preparing to give him the kiss of life. The mere thought was enough to jerk anyone from the borders of consciousness. He sat up, trying to shed the feeling that he weighed several tons and was covered in scales. "We did it," he whispered. "The dragon. It came. I felt it." The brethren glanced at one another.
"Well, we never saw nothing," said Brother Plasterer.
"I might have seen something."
"Excuse me, it's the reading. That's what it is." "I might have seen something," said Brother Watchtower loyally.
"No, not here," snapped the Supreme Grandmaster.
"You hardly wanted to materialise here, do you?
It was out there, in the city, just for a few seconds," he pointed.
Look. The brethren turned around guiltily, expecting at any moment the hot flame of retribution. In the centre of the circle, the magic items were gently crumbling to dust, even as they watched Brother Dunnikin's amulet collapsed. Suck dry, whispered Brother Fingers. I'll be damned. $3 that amulet cost me, muttered Brother Dunnikin. But it proves that it works. Don't you see, you fools? It works. We can summon dragons. It could be a bit expensive in magical items, said Brother Fingers, doubtfully. $3 it was. No rubbish. Power, growled the Supreme Grandmaster, does not come cheap. Very true, nodded Brother Watchtower. Not cheap, very true. He looked at the little heap of exhausted magic again. Cool, we did it though, didn't we? We only went and blooming well did some magic, right? See, said Brother Fingers, I told you there was nothing to it. You all did exceptionally well, said the Supreme Grandmaster encouragingly. Should have been $6, but he said he'd cut his own throat and sell it to me for $3. Yeah, said Brother Watchtower, we got the hang of it all right. Didn't hurt a bit. We done real magic. And didn't get eaten by two fairies out of the woodwork either, Brother Plasterer. I couldn't help noticing. The other brethren nodded. Real magic, nothing to it. Everyone had just better watch out. Hang on, no, said Brother Plasterer. Where's this dragon gone? I mean, did we really summon it or not? Fancy you asking a silly question like that, said Brother Watchtower doubtfully. The Supreme Grandmaster brushed the dust off his mystic robe. We summoned it, he said, and it came back, but only as long as the magic lasted. Then it went back. If we want it to stay longer, we need more magic. Do you understand? And that is what we must get. $3 I shan't see again in an hurry. Shut up! Dearest Father, wrote Carrot. Well, here I am in Ankh Morpork. It's not like at home. I think it must have changed a bit since Mr. Veneshi's great-grandfather was here. I don't think people here know right from wrong. I found Captain Vimes in a common alehouse. I remembered what you said about a good dwarf not going into such places, but since he did not come out, I went in. He was lying with his head on a table. When I spoke to him, he said, pull the other one, kid. It's got bells on. I believe he was the worse for drink. He told me to find a place to stay and report to Sergeant Colon at the watch house tonight. He said anyone wanting to join the guard needed their head examined. Mr. Farnishi did not mention this. Perhaps it is done for reasons of hygiene. I went for a walk. There are many people here. I found a place. It's called the Shades. Then I saw some men trying to rob a young lady. I set about them. They did not know how to fight properly, and one of them tried to kick me in the vitals, but I was wearing the protective as instructed, and he hurt himself. Then the lady came up to me, and she said, was I interested in bed? And I said, yes. She took me to where she lived, a boarding house, I think it was called. It's run by a lady called Mrs. Palm, the lady whose purse it was. She is called Reet, she said. You should have seen him. There were three of them. It was amazing. Mrs. Palm said, it's on the house. I said, what, a big protective? So I went upstairs and fell asleep. Well, that's a very noisy place. Reet woke me up once or twice to say, do you want anything? But they had no apples. So I've fallen on my feet, as they say here. I don't know how that's possible, because if you fall off your feet, it is common sense. Because if you fall off your feet. It is common sense. There is certainly a lot to do here. When I went to see the sergeant, I saw a place called the Thieves Guild. I asked Mrs. Palm, and she said, of course. She said the leaders of the thieves in the city meet there. I went to the watch house and I met Sergeant Colon, a very fat man, and when I told him about the Thieves Guild, he said, don't be an idiot. I do not think that he's serious, he says. Don't you worry about the Thieves Guilds. This is all what you have to do. You walk along the streets at night shouting it's 12 o'clock and all's well. I said, well, what if it's not well? And he said, you bloomin' well find another street. This is not leadership. I've been given some chainmail. It's rusty and not well made. They give you money for being a guard. $20 a month. When I get it, I will send you it. I hope you're all well and that shaft number 5 is now open. This afternoon I will go and look at the Thieves Guild. It is disgraceful. If I do something about it, it will be a feather in my cap. I'm getting the hang of how they talk here already. Your loving son, Carrot. P.S. Please give all my love to Minty. I really miss her. Lord Veterinary, the patrician of Ankh Morpork, put his hands over his eyes.
He did what?
I was marched through the streets, said Erdo Van Pugh, current president of the Guild of Thieves, Burglars and Allied Trouters, in broad daylight, with my hands tied together. He took a few steps toward the patrician's severe chair of office, waving a finger. You know very well that we have kept within the budget, he said. To be humiliated like that, like a common criminal, there had better be a full apology, he said, or you will have another strike on your hands. We will be driven to it, despite our natural civic responsibilities, he added. It was the finger. The finger was a mistake. The patrician was staring coldly at the finger. Van Pugh followed his gaze and quickly lowered the digit. The patrician was not a man he shook a finger at unless he wanted to end up being able to count only 9.
And you say this was one person, said Lord Veterinary.
Yes, that is, Van Pugh hesitated. It did sound weird, now he came to tell someone.
But there are hundreds of you in there, said the patrician calmly. Thick as, you should excuse the expression, thieves.
Van Pugh opened and shut his mouth a few times. The honest answer would have been yes, and if anyone had come sidling in and skulking around the corridors, it would have been the worse for them. It was the way he strode in, as if he owned the place, that fooled everyone, that and the fact that he kept hitting people and telling them to mend their ways.
The patrician nodded. I shall deal with the matter momentarily, he said.
It was a good word. It always made people hesitate. They were never quite sure whether he meant to deal with it now or just deal with it briefly, and no one ever dared ask. Van Pugh backed down.
A full apology, mark you. I have a position to maintain, he added. Thank you. Do not let me detain you, said the patrician, once again giving the language his own individual spin.
Right. Good. Very well. Thank you, said the thief.
After all, you have so much work to do.
Lord Veterinary went on. Well, of course, this is the case. The thief hesitated. The patrician's last remark had barbs on it. You found yourself waiting for him to strike. He said, hoping for you.
With so much business being conducted, that is.
Panic took over the thief's features. Randomised guilt flooded his mind. It wasn't a case of what had he done, it was a question of what the patrician had found out about. The man had eyes everywhere, none of them so terrifying as the icy blue ones just above his nose.
I don't follow, he began. Curious choice of targets, the patrician picked up a sheet of paper. For example, a crystal ball belonging to a fortune teller in Shear Street. A small ornament from the temple of Ofla, the crocodile god, and so on.
Gugors.
I'm afraid I really don't know, said the head thief.
The patrician leaned forward.
No unlicensed thieving, surely, he said.
One of the remarkable innovations introduced by the patrician was to make the Thieves' Guild responsible for theft with annual budgets, forward planning, and above all, rigid job protection. Thus, in return for an agreed average level of crime per annum, the thieves themselves saw to it that unauthorised crime was met with the full force of injustice, which was generally a stick with nails in it.
I shall look upon it directly, stuttered the head thief. Depend upon it.
The patrician gave him a sweet smile.
I'm sure I can, he said. Thank you for coming to see me. Don't hesitate to leave.
The thief shuffled out. It was always like this with the patrician, he reflected bitterly. You came to see him with a perfectly reasonable complaint. Next thing you knew, you were shuffling out backwards, bowing and scraping, relieved simply to be getting away. You had to hand it to the patrician, he admitted grudgingly. If you didn't, he sent men to come and take it away. When he'd gone, Lord Veterinary rang the little bronze bell that summoned his secretary. The man's name, despite his handwriting, was Lupine Once. He appeared, pen poised. You could say this about Lupine Once. He was neat. He always gave the impression of just being completed. Even his hair was so smoothed down and oiled it looked as though it had been painted on.
"The watch appears to have some difficulty with the new Thieves Guild," said the patrician. "Van Pugh has been in here claiming that a member of the watch arrested him."
"What for, sir?"
"Being a thief, apparently."
"A member of the watch," said the secretary.
"I know. But just sort it out, will you?"
The patrician smiled to himself. It was always hard to fathom Lord Veterinary's idiosyncratic sense of humour, but a vision of the red-faced, irate head thief kept coming back to him. One of the patrician's greatest contributions to the reliable operation of Ankh-Morpork had been very early in his administration, the legalising of the ancient Guild of Thieves. "Crime was always with us," he reasoned, "and therefore, if you were going to have crime, it should at least be organised crime." And so the guild had been encouraged to come out of the shadows and build a big guild house, take their place at civic banquets, and set up their training college with day release courses and city and guild certificates and everything. In exchange for the winding down of the watch, they agreed, while trying to keep their faces straight, to keep crime levels to a level to be determined annually. That way, everyone could plan ahead, said Lord Veterinary, and part of the uncertainty had been removed from the chaos that is life. And then, a little while later, the patrician summoned the lead in thieves again and said, Oh, by the way,
there was something else.
What was it now?
Oh, yes. I know who you are, he said. I know where you live. I know what kind of horse you ride. I know where your wife has her hair done. I know where your lovely children.
How old are they now? My time doesn't fly.
I know where they play, so you won't forget about what we agreed, will you?
And he smiled. So did they, after a fashion. And in fact, it had turned out very satisfactory from everyone's point of view. It took the head thieves a very little time to grow paunches and start having coats of arms made and meet in a proper building rather than smoky dens, which no one had liked much. A complicated arrangement of receipts and vouchers saw to it that while everyone was eligible for the attentions of the guild, no one had too much, and this was very acceptable, at least to those citizens who were rich enough to afford the quite reasonable premiums the guild charged for an uninterrupted life. There was a strange foreign word for this, in-sewer ants. No one knew exactly what it had originally meant, but Ankh-Morpork had made its own. The watch hadn't liked it, but the plain fact was that the thieves were far better at controlling crime than the watch had ever been. After all, the watch had to work twice as hard to cut crime just a little, whereas all the guild had to do was work less. And so the city prospered, while the watch had dwindled away like a useless appendix into a handful of unemployables who no one in their right mind could ever take seriously. The last thing anyone wanted them to do was get into their heads to fight crime, but seeing the head thief discommoded was always worth the trouble, the patrician felt. There you go. Is it a good idea? Gieveshild? A thieves guild? I don't know. I've never really thought about it. I'm not a patrician. I'm not even a Lord Mayor. Is it a good idea? I suppose you can control the crime. There you go. Worth thinking of it. Was Terry onto something there? Anyway, thanks very much for listening. Good night. Unless you're here for a bit of waffle. I can give you a bit of waffle if you want. So today for me was... what way around are we? Hang on. Friday for me today. And today... I wasn't at that other school today. I was at my normal school today. And I got to lead the very last celebration assembly of the year, which was nice. That was good fun. What else happened today? I don't know. It was quite a nice little Friday. There was that Friday mood about, you know, and also the mood of 3 working days left. That was very much in the air today. So, yeah, let's hope for the final 3 days that lovely feeling is also in the air. I love it. That's about it. I told you that Blake finishes today at university, but he's got, I think he's part of the Rock Society, he hasn't ever told me whether it's picking up large stones and going, mm-hmm, or whether it's strapping on guitars and going, mm-hmm, that kind of rock society. I don't know. I'm presuming a second because he's into his rock. He's not into his rock. But so he's got a meal with them tomorrow, Christmas dinner with them. Then he's coming home on Sunday. And that's, he's here then till the 7th of January. That's nice. That's about it. I've got to take Phoebe tomorrow into the nearby town to have her nails done. That's my gossip. That's my excitement, I'm afraid. I'll tell you what. We have, with my work, we have a group chat. And every Friday, we have a question to answer. Let me just see if I can find the question today. So today's question, or this week's question, which I'm saying so you can answer me. What is your, number one, Christmas drink? Number two, Christmas song? And number three, Christmas film? For your evening tonight, for your Christmassy evening tonight, your Christmas drink, your Christmas song, and your Christmas film. What is yours? I put on the group chat, whiskey, number one. That's my Christmas drink. Specifically, and there are other brands available, one called Monkey Shoulder. Might get a freebie if I say it, might not. My song, number two, Last Christmas by Wham. And film, number three. I cheated here. I put two. One of them I have to watch on my own, and one of them I watch with like the kids. So the one I watch on my own, because no one else will watch it with me, is a Netflix special called A Very Murray Christmas with Bill Murray, you know, out of Ghostbusters. I don't know why. It's a bit ridiculous. I just really like it. I do. I just sit there and I watch it every year on my own, and I love it. And the other one that I watch with everybody is Wonderful Life, of course. Most Christmassy film out there. Surely, surely. But let me know yours. Christmas drink, Christmas song, Christmas film. There you go. You can join in with my work chat. Look. All right. Okay. Thanks very much for listening. And I'll see you all tomorrow. Saturday.